Welcome to Cinematic Obsessions, a TV show about movies, cinematography, producers, directors, even some risque topics we're going to discuss today. This is Frank Avila, your host. Yes, I normally do political shows and more serious shows, but we do, as you know, in our viewing audience, shows dealing with cultural issues and issues from Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts, religious issues. We've had Ice Cube on, Edward James, almost the actor, and today we have three young men, some very impressive young men, who are associated in movies both in their avocation as well as their vocation. On my right, I have my co-host, Anisa Peraica, who is also a fan of movies.
Yes,
and
I am.
Could be a movie star, but right now just works in the TV industry.
That's cool.
And I have some of the employees of Odd Obsession Movies, who have done some movies themselves and associated with non-for-profit groups that produce old, foreign, hard-to-get, low-budget films that perhaps are not received in this kind of big Pac-Man of Hollywood and big-budget films. And I have, from left to right, it is Joe, Andrew, and Kelvin. Joe, Andrew, and Kelvin, thank you for being on our show. I want to talk a little bit about movies generally. I want to talk a little bit about the store and a little bit for the viewing audience that feels left out of major movies in Hollywood. And similar to that, if you like Cable Access Network, yes, we are a low-budget show. We are kind of the serious Wayne's World here with politics and the like. And if you want to keep us on, you have to support either opposition to or the amendments on, which I believe have passed, at least the Senate, I think going to the House, of what is known as the AT&T Bill 1500 in the House. So you keep cable access, local origination, and cable access TV and programs like this. And I believe that we shouldn't just have album-oriented rock or national or international, everybody's controlling. One thing I like about YouTube and iPod, people can do their own. This is America. This is the United States of America, and let creativity and let individual choice reign, and let people have things like older movies, foreign films, independent films, low-budget films, and that's why it's so important we're doing a show like this right now.
And speaking of that, just to get started, can you guys talk about a little bit about what the store specializes in, what type of genres, and what type of customers maybe you get?
Typically, we try to stay pretty diverse. We have a lot of international cinema. Pretty much every country making movies today has a section, as well as, in general, American films from the dawn of cinema up through present, silent, early westerns, the 60s and 70s sort of maverick movement that happened with directors bringing their own aesthetics to film. Up through current films being made right now, they're in the low-budget independent media or just the avant-garde.
Tell us some of the Indian film industry is very big. Because of my own heritage, I've always been a fan of the Cantinflas films and Pedro Infante or Pedro Aguilar and some of the Mexican films, some great comedy. And then when I was in Croatia, some of them said there's a great Yugoslavian or Serbian film industry. Tell us a little bit about the international film industry, what's being done uniquely, if because America and specifically Chicago is so diverse, so many different groups, if that's one of the markets you appeal to. But tell us a little bit about the international film market.
Yeah, you know, we have an expert at the store who's actually specializes in Russia, Balkan states, that said, I wish he was here right now. But I know that obviously every country brings their own aesthetics to the way the films are made, and in some cases aren't made. Obviously certain states have things that are still taboo, things that are still impossible to achieve based on budgets they're allocated, which is the exact opposite of a place like Germany where you could actually get government funding to make a film. Films are tax-deductible expenses.
So do you have people who come in asking specifically for like a certain German film or Russian film? Is that how you know which films you guys want to have in the stores?
Absolutely,
and stuff?
Yeah.
Just based on customer demand?
Yeah, we try to pretty much figure out what the customers want and then mm-hmm. order accordingly. Obviously,
do you have like a lot of loyal customers who come in? Like they're, you know, you're their favorite place because you have this movie that they can't find at, say, Blockbuster or some other commercial type of outlet. So they come to you, and are they happy? Do they give you any feedback about their other experiences?
Absolutely, yeah. I don't think the store would exist if people were going elsewhere. Mm-hmm. Personally, that's how I ended up working there. It was just, you know, once I discovered it was there, I stopped going anywhere else. And after a while, you're there often enough, and you just end up getting swept up into it.
And what about you guys? I know Joe and Calvin. How did you end up there and your experiences
all
there?
We ended up just being customers, and we'd come into the store. And eventually we befriended the owner, his name is Brian, and either by simply asking, oh, do you need help shelving something, or him, in some cases, asking us, do you mind watching the place for a half hour, like run to the bank, or something like that, we all ended up sort of working there. And the interesting thing is that none of us get paid. We're all there on a volunteer basis. We're all there.
So wait, let me back up for a second. None of you are paid employees.
No.
You're volunteers. Never heard of a volunteer or a video star.
We're here for our love of film, our love of spreading our love of film, and trying to expose as many people as possible to just general cinema that they're not going to see.
Joe, Andrew, Calvin, are you formally trained in film? Is that what you went to school for? I know there's Columbia here in Chicago. Or is it just a hobby? Maybe each of you could answer that.
I'm not formally trained in film, but I know a lot about it. I guess you could say it's a hobby of mine. So I get a lot out of the store. I may not get money out of the store, but there's a lot of non-monetary, profits from working at the store. You get involved in the network of movies in Chicago.
You kind of find out a lot of more of the underground too, right? What's really where things are showing and how to find out, really, because it's difficult. There's not really many places where you can find out what kind of movies are only for specific audiences.
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question?
If you were formally trained in film.
No, I'm, again, strictly, like, as with Calvin, very much an enthusiast.
How did you become an enthusiast?
I've always been interested in film. I come from a small town in Pennsylvania, and there was nothing like the store, you know, back there. So,
Deer Hunter, great film.
Yeah.
Good Wedding Sing.
Yeah, it's one we carry. You know, we try to carry all the important American films from the 60s and 70s. But yeah, I mean, that's when you think of Pennsylvania, that's not out of the realm of, you know, where I'm talking about. So, it was really very much a culture shock. Not so much moving to the city, but finding the store that really fit what I had in my head of what I was looking for. So, there's really no place I'd rather spend my free time.
I mean, like I just said earlier, we all pretty much came there because there wasn't another place in Chicago that really specialized in the films which you weren't going to find at Blockbuster, or even more supposedly specialty stores like Nationwide Video or Specialty Video.
Well, let's talk about that, but before we do, why don't you set up, we have a clip of what the store specializes in, and just set it up for us.
The clip.
Don't we have a first clip, what the store specializes in?
The clips are a documentary about him working at the store. So you just get a glimpse of the store.
Foreign Kid Joe, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, which will be
Can you set
okay.
it up a little
why,
bit?
Why don't you set up that clip,
okay.
And then let's see the clip of Porn Kid Joe.
Yeah. Well, that is
And for our viewing audience, there's no nudity in this clip.
Or profanity.
Or profanity. However, young children may not want to see this clip. I don't know. I haven't seen it. So tell us a little. Set up the clip.
I think I might be actually the only one who knows what's on the clip because I made it tonight.
You made it, and he's starring in it. Right?
Yes. Okay, it's a documentary about.
Now, you're not a porn star, though. Is that
no.
Correct? Okay.
Not really.
Yeah.
You're so half and half. You're almost. A
is that what
no,
that was?
No, he's almost a porn star. But he's mostly a porn historian. And these clips. There's three clips. One is him introducing a porn that he showed at Music Box a while ago. The second clip is his parents talking about him working at Odd Obsession. And the third clip is actually him at Odd Obsession.
Okay. Well, why don't we see the first clip, which is Porn Kid Joe?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Let's take a look at this clip.
to introduce the film historian tonight. Local film historian on pornography, classic pornography. Here he is. Round of applause.
Objection to Joe working at the store? None whatsoever, as a matter of fact. I think it's constructive. And I also think that it gives Joe an opportunity to come in contact with people. I would prefer him to come in contact with some of his peers. Mm-hmm. At school. It's preferable, but if he doesn't, better than nothing. I don't want him to be a hermit. And we are his parents, and we are his friends. We are not his pals. And the other thing, that's our bird.
I pre-decide I hate every single film made past 1985, and then when I watch them, I find that some of them affect me so much that despite my predisposed hatred of them, I end up liking them and admiring them very much.
Is there a bit of where the wild things are, like that big?
Yeah.
Bull. Hey, how is Spike Jones making a movie of where the wild things are?
That's weird.
Who is Spike Jones, and how is he different from Spike Lee?
Oh, he sucks, and you hate him because he's terrible and disgusting.
Yeah, I hate him. Yeah. He doesn't let
what has he done?
Skateboard.
You know, he's John Malkovich adaptation.
Yeah. Oh, I saw both of those. The adaptation was okay. It wasn't as awful as I thought it would be.
Married to this.
Of course he is. And she makes just gems, doesn't she?
I actually like Sofia Coppola a lot.
Lost in Translation.
Both the Coppola offspring I like a lot more than Francis Ford Coppola himself, which is very unfortunate for him that they're both kind of...
I think better than he felt that he is. Calvin, tell us about what we just saw.
Well, we just saw three aspects of Joe's life. I've been filming Joe for about a year. Yeah, for about a year now.
You're not filming Joe in pornographic activities, though, is that correct?
That's correct. I just film his life outside of those activities.
So Porno Kid Joe has nothing to do with Joe's life as a porno star?
No, right. he's more of a porn historian. I guess he would call himself the third leading porn expert in the United States.
Who are the first two?
Yeah.
I'd venture to say the late Jim Holiday, who passed away around 2 years ago of diabetes, I think. And
so that knocked you up to number two, then?
How old was he?
At least it wasn't AIDS, I see.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's one of the big myths, that not nearly as many people in that industry have AIDS or are really in contact with AIDS. But the second one I'd say is probably Chuck Green, who's a guy who's been working in this industry as a producer since 1973.
Well, finish telling us about the rest of the clip we saw.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, these clips show, you know, Joe presenting a movie that he owned the film print of and showed at the Music Box. And, you know, he talks about porn films in a very unusual way. I mean, he has an unusual interest in them. It's not in the normal way someone would be interested in them. He's interested in them for historical reasons, for artistic reasons. So basically, I've been filming him talking about these things and doing movie-related things and stuff like that. So... right now we're finishing editing up the movie, and these were just a few samples.
And so you're planning to release it when and where?
Later this year, we're going to start submitting it to film festivals.
Okay.
You mentioned the Music Box. We can't do any commercials, as you know, on Cable Access Network, but just tell us about the Music Box, what the Music Box is. I know that sometimes it has expositions of other films, avant-garde, or films that you wouldn't see if you went to Cineplex Odeon or Lowe's.
It's a revival and art theater. It specializes in showing the films that places, like the ones you just mentioned, really wouldn't dare showing because they know they're not going to get an audience. And I mean, what makes the music box nice is that it really is a place for cinematic voices which don't really get other exposure.
Now, I wanted to see that movie, and I didn't get a chance, about the monks, and it's supposed to be all silent, and it had like excellent reviews, especially those in even non-Christian monastic areas, but even among like traditional Catholics. It was a monastic film, just a bunch of monks, and I guess it's silent. I guess it has noise, but no voice, no drama. I don't know if you're familiar with that film. I don't even know the name of it.
Title or when it came out?
Recently, in the last couple months.
Yeah, we reviewed it on Cinephile. It's a website that we all kind of write for.
And this is a non-for-profit, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, give us the Cinephile website, so if anybody wants to go on and see it. Do you remember the name of the movie?
I personally don't remember because I didn't see it and I didn't write about it, but I remember it was reviewed on there. But the address is www.cine-file.info.
Okay. Cine-file.info.
Yes.
And what is the nature of the website?
The website is designed to give people information about movies that don't really get a lot of press, you know, not commercial films that get reviews in the major papers and stuff like that. So we just kind of let people aware of what's going on in Chicago each week.
And you mentioned you did reviews. Do any of the reviews show up on the website, or is that
they do?
They all do. Okay.
Yeah, we have all three of us contribute to the site. We write reviews for it of the films that we read about or hear coming to various non-mainstream theaters, like no AMC, no Lowe's. Mainly university theaters like UFC Doc or Lock Cinema, Northwestern, or Music Box, or Century Theater. Like the theaters that really show films that appeal to a more aesthetic sensibility rather than just like a commercial Hollywood sensibility.
Mm-hmm. And before we were talking, you mentioned revival screenings. Is that related to that, or is that something that's different? Okay. Could you talk a little bit about that?
The poster down here, but we're working with an organization called the Chicago Cinema Forum, and they are...
If they want to hone in on me, you can talk while we're doing it.
Yeah, that is a group, or like a few people who are trying to...
You could hold it while you're...
They're trying to promote lost European films, American films.
All right, give it back to me. Keep on talking. They're going to hone this in right on me. Or should I have Anisa Peraica hold it? She's better looking than I am.
Yeah, at least for
straight porn type of films, but go on.
The Chicago Cinema Forum is an organization which is dedicated to providing information and revival screenings of films which are currently not accessible on DVD or video, just like very, very good, but unfortunately unheard of films, primarily European, some American as well, and it's going out to LaSalle Bank Theater.
Okay. Where's LaSalle Bank Theater?
I'm not quite sure, do you know? I'm not quite sure either.
It's on the back of the card, which is, check it out on their website, chicagocinemaforum.org. I guess that's 4901 West Irving Park. And again, I would go on their website, which is not-for-profit, cine-file.info. Now, let's talk about some of your interesting customers, because I imagine you could probably do a movie about the video store without making fun of it. I'm sure you get a lot of eccentric customers who come in, a lot of very interesting people, people who are probably very interesting of themselves, even eccentric. Maybe each of you has an anecdote or a story about a customer. You don't have to give their last name but what are some of the more interesting customers and characters that come in the show, in the store?
Well, I mean, obviously there are certain characters, everyone gets a nickname after a long enough time, which works out well since that way...
They don't know it.
Right. No one who's being discussed has to worry about anybody knocking down their door. But, in a lot of the cases, there are best customers, and by virtue of being there so often, some stories end up circulating. I would say, it's difficult to think of anecdotes that can be shared to...
We don't want to violate anybody's privacy.
Of course.
But if there is anything interesting that you can share about interesting customers...
There was a guy who hasn't come in probably over a year since we used to have another. We used to be on Halsted and North Avenues. The store used to be, and then almost exactly 1 year ago, on the 1st of June, actually, that was our 1 year anniversary, we moved to Milwaukee. And at the old location, there was a guy who used
the Wicker Park area.
Yeah, the Wicker Park, and more of our customers live in that area, and that's more of an artist area,
sure,
and whatnot, younger. But there used to be a guy who came into the old store.
Famous Sinatra movies were filmed in Wicker Park.
Such as?
I forget the name, but one where...
The Golden Nine?
Yeah, with the about heroin dealers. Actually, Wicker Park was known about being heroin dealers, actually, Polish heroin dealers. And I believe that the Sinatra movie filmed in Wicker Park is about heroin dealing.
On Division, I think it was.
Yeah. Not a bad movie, but I haven't seen it recently. But go on.
Right. Well, yeah, there's a guy who used to come to the old location who... he was a Vietnam vet, not a Vietnam vet, a Gulf War vet, and apparently he'd gotten shot somewhere, and it was like something that he always had to talk about, but he was just a really, really weird little guy. He was like probably 5'4", like came in, and he referred to the owner, like I said his name earlier, like his name is Brian, he referred to the owner as Flying Brian. And that became his nickname, and he was just this weird little guy who would, like, come in asking for the most, like, the strangest things. And, like, it would range from ultra-obscure, really good blaxploitation to just, like...
When you say blaxploitation, are you talking, like, Blackula, Black Caesar,
Shaft? Yeah, kind of, like,
Shaft,
things like that, yeah. Like, so, like, really good stuff like that, like, The Spooky Side of the Door, which is sort of like a...
The CIA, it's based on a very classic book of black nationalistic power.
Yeah. And then he'd, like, tell us about...
By the way, Spooky Stood by the War is a very good movie actually. And just as a plug for it, it's a about a guy who trained with the CIA who's black, and then he trains, like, janitors to steal things and light-skinned black people to do things. And I thought it was very fascinating, very 60s, though, I think, or maybe 70s.
73.
73, okay.
Yeah, we're the only place in the city that has it. Look for that.
The Spook Who Stood by the Door. Yeah.
But he was just like this weird little guy, but he would show up at like 2 in the morning and be banging on the door of the store, like hoping to be let in, because someone would be there like way, way, way after hours. And he then, like, he started telling us about how he wanted to film, like, weird fat people in his backyard and, like, make his homegrown, like, Girls Gone Wild type movies, and he just went totally insane. He turned out he lived at the VA hospital.
Oh, really?
So he was just a weird case.
Do you have Blackula and Black Caesar?
Yeah.
They have one of the city's better blaxploitation sections, actually.
Because a lot of black empowerment people love The Spook Who Stood by the Door, which was based on a book.
Mm-hmm.
I know Shaft has been kind of satirized, but these were films that were kind of avant-garde for the time and popular at the time.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
I mean, like, one of the things that the store really tries to do is find films that you really can't find anywhere else, and that's either because they're never released in the U.S. or they're never put on DVD or video. And, I mean, we have, like, a whole network of collectors we go to who just spend all of their free time, they're movie-obsessed like us. They just find anything they can. And
Really, you said before the show you did not have the black and white Marlon Brando, Anthony Quinn, Viva Zapata, and I don't know who wrote the screenplay, if it was either Steinbeck or Hemingway. It's an excellent film. I cannot find it. It's on the internet, but it's a good film. Please look for it. Viva Zapata. It's with Marlon Brando and Anthony Quinn. Excellent film, and I'd like to get it, or at least see it again.
Can you guys talk about individually each of your favorite films, just what, as your experience, and you have so much knowledge of film, what do you feel is the best film out there, your favorite one?
Currently or just overall?
Overall, of all time. Any, yeah.
Well, give us one current one that you liked.
And then one of
non-porn.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, my best film of last year was The Death of Mr. Lazarescu, which is... Is it a Czech film?
I'm not sure. I think it's Romanian, actually.
Romanian. It's... Well, essentially what it is, it's a really scathing indictment of just like a look at how awful the Eastern European hospital system is, and it chronicles in essentially real time the last 2.5 hours of a guy's life after he like first has stomach pains in his apartment and is then literally brought from one hospital to another because none of them have room, and gets just third-rate medical attention because he looked at him as like a drunk and a useless one, like just like a useless person. It's really sort of shocking that from our American standpoint, just getting a glimpse into how Eastern Europe has really neglected something like its medical facilities.
What's your favorite movie of all time?
I venture to say, it's a hard question, but I venture to say The Holy Mountain from 1973 by Alejandro Jodorowsky, and it's his sort of epic look at politics, social policies, and done with some of the most amazing visuals ever put on film. Some of the best sets ever.
When you come on next, I'd like to get some clips. What's your favorite movie?
The best movie I've seen in the theater recently would have been The Host. It's a South Korean film. I'd say it's probably equal parts horror monster film and family comedy. Yeah, it's interesting if you look at films that come from poorer countries in the world. Not that South Korea is especially poor, but it's primarily agricultural, you know, the rice paddies everywhere outside of Seoul. And people don't have a lot of money to go to the movies. When you do, typically the films that make the most money at the box office within the country are the ones that most definitely combine different genre elements. You know, so that way everyone feels they've gotten, you know, their money's worth, they've gotten something of everything.
Best movie of all time?
How to Succeed in Business Without Really Trying.
Which was a Broadway or musical?
It was a musical that was adapted into a film that was originally based on a book of the same name, having nothing to do, from what I understand, the book is actually a guide to succeeding in business. A story was then crafted around the book, which was adapted into a play, and that was further adapted into a movie.
Calvin?
I really like Inner Space, which is a movie by Joe Dante, the guy who did Gremlins. And it's a movie that stars Dennis Quaid, and he gets shrunk, much like in Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, into a little space shuttle that flies through the human body.
It was a mainstream movie.
It was a mainstream movie. It came out in the 80s, yeah. And I saw Dennis Quaid recently. So.
Well, real quickly before we go, tell us your website again for the non-for-profit cinephile.info. For any reviews, we definitely have to bring you back again. And then when we could see Porn Kid Joe. When can we see it?
Oh, we'll see it in a couple months.
Okay.
And
website.
The
website? cine-file.info.
Great. Well, thank you guys for coming on. We really appreciate it. Joe, Andrew, and Calvin, be sure to check out the website and to come back soon. Thank you, Frank.
Well, if we don't see you at the movies, we'll see you at the show.
Definitely.
Or at the store, I mean.
My name's Anisa Peraica. Good night. Thank you.